folks, welcome inside the Parisi Palace, high above 3773 East Broadway. This is a live edition of the Jake Feinberg Show, comedy on Power Talk. Thank you so much for making us part of your day today. And it's really funny how the spirits work in this world, because long ago, back when I was in elementary school, I was a sports fanatic and I was obsessed with baseball and statistics and the flow of the game, and I love sports, and I was always fantasizing about broadcasting about sports. And then a funny thing happened as you grow up, is you just begin to prioritize and sort of begin to see what is really authentic and what is not. And as sports became more and more corporate, I veered farther and farther away from that and more into the realm of healing through rhythm, and especially live rhythm and music, and then discovering and reaching into the records that I collected and pulling out these shaman musicians to be able to tell me the truth about leadership and love and overcoming adversity and the lineage of all music. And that's going on 9 years. And my guest today is somebody who saw me at that time and knew me very well at that time. I used to be at his house, and he was already probably thinking about arrangements and putting together folk songs, and I was demanding to watch the Mets baseball game with the Pirates or play wiffle ball, and he was in a different bag. And it turns out that as a result, through a couple of interviews I did recently with a couple of Brooklynites, it just was total serendipity. They mentioned his name. I said, "You have to be kidding me," and because they collaborate with him. And the coolest thing about my guest is that to a man, everybody says, truly just a heart of gold. But man, you put the apparatus around him, the guitar, whatever, and it's just like a house of fire. And those are the best people in the world, man, because they're playing from their soul and they're playing fearlessly. And what an honor to reconnect. Josh Kaufman, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Jake, it's an honor, man. I'm so psyched to be able to hang out. Well, finally, after a long time. Well, I remember those days really, really well, man.
I was going to say, I mean, I don't want to be blowing smoke here. I mean, I remember actually getting into arguments with Mark Metz, and it was a defining moment of my life. Like, it was like, he was like, real, like, you were not a ball player. You didn't want to play baseball. Like, you weren't into it. Like, it was like, I remember him just like not being cool with you, and I had to really basically be like, I'm going home with my friend. That was a defining moment of my life. Like,
oh,
I went,
wow.
Yeah,
wow,
man. It was deep, man.
I didn't find the cut really there to fit in.
You weren't in the cut. No, it was not.
Yeah, wasn't in the cut. Yeah. But, okay.
Now, you found your groove.
Yeah, you find it eventually. But, I remember those days, and I remember watching like Seven Samurai with you and your dad too. And
whoa, dude, that was dude, man, you're bringing up some deep stuff, man. I haven't thought about that since that time, man.
And that, amazing. And I remember your I remember sleepover party for your I think it was your 10th.
Yeah,
I think you turned 10. We are we were all around the same age. Oh,
well,
man,
I mean, this is,
amazing.
I mean,
I remember it really well.
Well, this is the cosmic part. So, I mean, we're just going to just be rolling to set one here with Josh Kaufman. But this is my life. Fundamentally, things changed November 22nd, 2019. So we have a game on this program called Name That Voice. I'm going to put this in for you, and then we'll come back and break it down. Okay?
Okay.
You just blew my mind. This is why the spirit is, it's so beautiful. Boyfriends, going back to that, I cannot believe that you just dropped the name Josh Kaufman. He was one of my best friends growing up. Like, he lived a block.
Oh, my God. I just got a text from Josh while we were...
Well, of course, no, you just let him know Jake Feinberg on Quaker Path, and we're cooking the groove. He's going to lose his mind. But dude, we were so tight for a long time, dude. And he's a badass.
How great is that?
That's
guy?
So... I mean, and dude, he was kind of always into... He was, like, kind of hip. I mean, before I was hip, Like,
he was so hip, dude. He's the coolest. I love him. He's, like, so, like, delicate and, like, slight in his, like, persona. And he's just such a badass, on so many levels. He's so cool, and I just love it. I'll definitely love
him. Dude, no, you know what's cool is I would. I'm gonna go out of my way to see Boyfriends because I truthfully I haven't seen.
Oh, please do.
I haven't seen him perform live ever. I mean, we were like literally in elementary school together. Like, so this is like we lived on Quaker Path. I mean, just let him know Jake Feinberg sends his love. That is unreal.
Definitely let him know that. That's so cool. Yeah, you got to come. I mean, he is phenomenal. You know, I connected with him when we were making all these records with Craig Finn from the Hold Steady. Josh brought me in with that, and we just have formed this bond over the last, you know, 4 or 5 years that's just so deep. And what an honor it is to like play with him or to be like produced by him is so cool. I love it.
All right, Mr. Kaufman, who is that voice?
The one and only Joe Russo.
Oh my God, you are one for one. I mean, that it blew my mind. No, that was my interview with him from November of last year, and when he was going through these, you know, because, you know, like, J-Rad gets all the publicity, but then what is he really doing to feed his own soul? Like, what kind of bands does he have, or who does he work with? And he was talking about Parada, and then he talked about this band Boyfriends, and he dropped your name, and I was like, holy shit. I'm like, this has been the missing link. So, this is the question I have for you. I wanted to start, in your mind, at New Paul's in music school. You went to music school there?
Yeah. Okay.
What is something that you can honestly say that you learned in the academy that you can bring on the bandstand when there is a bandstand and people to play for? What is something that you can take from academia that has been fundamentally applicable to the bandstand for you?
That's a good question. I don't know that I enjoyed a lot of being around academic music for the perspective, but I don't know that it really gelled with me sort of emotionally. But I do think that the sort of language in certain circles of music theory and things getting inside this stuff with like a group of people and having like a shared language, but I would say that would be the big one there. But I had some cool teachers too who were like dick theory teachers that would just talk about publishing. You know what I mean? Stuff like that. So I think it's like a strange world, I think. Plus I was studying a lot more, you know, jazz and modern music and stuff, and less like traditional classical.
Yeah, which, I mean, well, because, like, you know, the Disco Biscuits, the keyboardist for them, Aaron Magner, he his professors at UPenn let him go on tour. Did you have a touring band? Did you do that upstate New York circuit?
Yeah, we did that whole circuit. I remember seeing them in those days, too. There was this band called Pooja. That was, like, me and...
Pooja?
And a friend, Pooja.
Oh, this is sick. This is sick.
And there was a... There was like a try to ignore these New York Times updates on my phone right now.
Sorry, dude.
And that's okay. Yeah. And but yeah, it was a great, like, thriving Northeast college music scene, and we would go basically like Thursday through sometimes Monday. We would be going from college to college in upstate New York and just throughout the Northeast, really, playing around little bars or at colleges. They would have, like, you know, I remember, like, Founders Day at Vassar College and things like that, all kinds of stuff. So, yeah, I remember.
No, I mean, you know what it is? What I'm trying to get at is, like, the idea that in music today, I don't like to paint with a broad brush. Obviously, it's right now we're stuck in neutral, but the... You know, especially as it relates to improvisational instrumental music, not so much singer-songwriter stuff, but when it, you know, some people might call that jazz, but there's like I find that there's a homogenization of sound that I can't really tell who people are, and I think it has a lot to do with that we're saturated with so much material that's available, and you know, people are coming out of colleges sounding like their professors. There's a pressure for conformity in music today, I feel. As opposed to all the cats that I interviewed, especially the drummers from the late 60s and jazz, where if somebody came up to them and was like, yo, man, you sounded great. You sounded just like so-and-so. They want to slit their wrists. Like, it was right, about about being an individual. And I wanted you to talk a little bit about your journey to find your sound and if it started at New Paul's or how that evolved.
I think, yeah, thanks for being interested.
No, this is the Jay Feinberg show.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man.
I think that, I guess I'm always improvising, even when I'm in the context of working with a songwriter. I don't know that there's any other way into a piece of music that makes me feel like I'm kind of shooting from the hip or feeling like I'm able to enter it emotionally, which is kind of everything for me. It's never been about being a virtuoso or technically proficient, but more about finding it a way into things emotionally. And I think getting into music and getting into playing improvisational music when you're like kind of at that like turning point of being like 15 through early 20s, mm-hmm. It's such an intense time to be a person growing up, right?
Oh,
and kind of everything is, you're kind of at that, like standing in the middle of a bridge, you know, and you've got your childhood behind you and you don't know what ahead of you. And it's just super emotional. I guess that's the only thing I can say. It's super personal. And I think if you can filter those feelings in some way through your work, through being in the moment, you kind of end up with that individuality that you're talking about.
Did you learn music by ear before you learned to sight read it?
Well, Jake, remind me again. Did you play trombone?
I played the bone, but I didn't take it seriously at all, and it was really unfortunate.
Right.
I was leading like a cadre of fools and riffraff, you know, like thinking that it was cool to like play the wrong notes. But yeah, I did play the bone for a minute. Yeah.
I was playing baritone horn.
Josh, my memory is so jaded. I feel like you bounced that back to New Jersey really early, but then I'm like, wait, but Evan Simpson knew him and Razika knew. So I'm like, when I lost the timeline on Kaufman. I mean, I know So were you playing baritone horn?
I was playing baritone horn starting in fifth or sixth grade, and through high school, but in the marching band and blah, 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 blah.
Sure.
But, and Scott Razika, that's right. He was also a baritone player.
That's right.
I think we sat
Kaufman,
next to each
that
other.
Is, oh my God, dude. This is making my day.
It's all starting to.
Yeah, it's all coming. It's congealing back.
I'm remembering some names now. Thank you for that.
Now, of course, Evan Simpson was also a picker. He played mandolin.
I remember him. He was really good. He played violin as well, right?
Dude, you are untouchable, right? I mean, this is so cathartic for me because, yeah, I'm still in touch with these guys. They are going to be cracked.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, man, please tell them I said
Kaufman, dude, Josh, yeah. this is a new portal for me now. We're back, man. We're back after years.
We're back, yeah. This is cool.
You know, but I mean, because Gary Bartz, the great horn player, he said that he works at Oberlin, and a lot of the cats that go there now, he said their ears are locked because they come in learning to read, you know, the old generation, the old guard, Charlie Parkers and those cats, the bebop guys, you know, they had the radio. They didn't have a rewind button, so they'd listen to whatever was on the radio, and they'd try to learn it in every key, and their ears were so open. Their ears were huge, and your ears are, and I'm thinking that you might have began your evolution as learning music by ear before reading it, but I just wanted you to talk about
that. I think that's right. Yeah, I mean, like when I so the reason I asked about the trombone and stuff like that was because, like, I think early on I had this experience with music in school where I was so excited at the idea of, I don't know if you remember, but they bring, I think it's in fifth grade, they bring in the horns to the class. classroom, and the music teacher like
right.
demonstrates each of them.
Yeah, right.
These are the sounds. They play like a B flat scale on each thing, and like that's what you know. And you're like, oh, cool. Okay, well, trumpet looks fun. Oh, everybody picked trumpet. Too many trumpets. Okay, what's left? Okay, I guess I finally have the nerve to say yes. I want to do this baritone horn and stuff. So we go in and we start learning the scales. And it was just, I couldn't get it. I couldn't remember the fingerings. I was trying to separate it into, it wasn't about the sound, it was about the fingerings.
Sure.
And I couldn't get the embouchure. And I remember the teacher kind of coming down on me really, really hard and kind of yelling at me like, you can remember your phone number, but you can't remember this scale. And I was just, I got like really like I got really upset, and I didn't want to practice anymore. And I stayed with it because it was like something to do in the day that wasn't being in class, right?
So I
hung with it, and the people in band were always cool. So it took a little while, and then when I got into music on my own when I was like 13, 14, there was this kid. I don't know if you remember him. Named Sean Quinlan.
Oh,
do you remember Sean Quinlan?
Dude, this is I can sort of see his face. I definitely remember the name.
He was a Mets guy too, so you probably like.
I just remember this vivid day where Mark Metz was being a total asshole to you, and I was like, you know what, dude, you can take your ball. I'm out of here, and I went home with you. You were really emotionally. It was really a defining moment of my life, dude. I remember I walked away. I was like, you know. I did the right thing, man. Kaufman's the man. But the thing is, here's the thing. Quinlan, was he a beast?
Sean was a cool dude, and he started playing guitar, and he started taking lessons.
Wow.
And he was a year older than us, but I was friendly with him just from being in the neighborhood, like riding bikes around the neighborhood kind of thing.
Great neighborhood, yeah.
And it was nice. And, we were lucky. And so Sean started playing, and he was playing this music that we were compelled by, you know, at the time. Like, it was like Neil Young and Led Zeppelin and the Byrds and the Doors. And so he had a couple guitars. So he had his electric guitar, but he had his mom's like nylon string guitar there too. And so I would go over after school, and we'd like, you know, hang around, and he'd want to play guitar, and I'd be like, okay, cool. And he'd show me like some basic chords so that I could play the rhythm part while he played over it, you know?
Oh, my
and
God. This is like Garcia and Weir, man. This is so Garcia and Weir. It's like Dana Morgan's studio, man. It's unreal.
This guy was so good when we were kids.
Wow.
I mean, probably still amazing. But
you don't know where this cat's at now? We got to find out where this cat is at.
I do. In fact, I played when I saw... It's flash forward, you know, however many years, and I'm at... like Red Rocks playing with Bob Weir, and Sean had bought tickets, and he somehow found me and got in touch and was like, hey man, I'm coming. He like lives out in Colorado now. And I put him on, you know, I put him on the backstage list, and he came back there, and we hung out, and it was a blast.
Wow.
I mean, it was so
dude.
Cool to reconnect.
Wow, yeah. Man. That is, so he really, when like, basically you guys were just putzing around after, I mean, he was already a music head, but he really was the one that kind of got you where it was like, you know, the teacher's yelling at you about arbiture and can't, you know, phone numbers and stuff, but Sean really put you on a path where it was like, wow, I got something going here. I got some momentum here.
Yeah, well, you need a friend at that age, you know, and you need a way to connect with that friend, and this seemed like something true. I mean, I can analyze it that way now, but like, I think that's what was going on. And I learned a lot, and it was so fun to be able to speak to someone that way, you know?
Exactly.
And I could just disappear into it. So then I started disappearing into it on my own, hanging out in my room and, recording myself on one boombox, playing guitar, playing it back in the room and playing over it into another boombox. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I could sort of like make my own little band. I very quickly just started making up my own stuff, just riffs and and music that felt good to me, and improvising over it. So that was like the very first stuff I wanted to do. I didn't even know what improvisation was, or that's what people called it. It felt cool to just sort of like let loose, you know?
Well, you're approaching it from like an experimental point of view. That's pretty hip stuff. I mean, you would say that, so at that time you were, do you still have some of those tapes?
I don't. I had a bunch of stuff through college, and some great stuff from college.
Yeah, the Pooja stuff I really need to hear. I'm hoping there's something available out there.
You know what, Jake? I can send you a CD because I have like a few of them. So right now, I'll just give you a picture.
Yeah.
We're in the middle of this like pandemic crisis.
I mean, you were in the epicenter of it. And I wanted to say, I really hope it hasn't gotten really real for you or your family. I pray that you guys are okay, you know?
Margie and Lee are good. Adam and his family are good. They all live in Brooklyn too.
Wow.
Annie, my wife, and I, and our daughter, Clarabelle, are all healthy. We're staying inside. We haven't left the apartment really, with the exception of a couple times in the last, 3.5 weeks.
That is remarkable. What part of Brooklyn do you live in?
We're in Brooklyn Heights. Where are you, Jake?
I'm in Tucson, Arizona.
Oh, that's right. You're in Tucson.
Yeah, I mean, but I Kaufman, the crazy thing is that, I mean, when Russo dropped that bomb, I mean, I was back. I've been living and raging in Williamsburg and Brooklyn, like just all, you know, Lunatico. I don't know. You ever play Lunatico before, that bar?
Oh, no, but I know it well, and lots of my buddies.
I know. Yeah. You're part of this milieu of authenticity that's, I mean, I have gone and woodshedded, and it's, yeah, anyway, I didn't want to really like harp on that, but I just recognize that like it for people out here, we are absolutely, we're staying inside too, but I can't imagine being in an epicenter of it. And so I really want you guys to, you know, my folks are still on that same house in Stony Brook, and they're just inside.
Oh, really?
Yeah, absolutely.
Richie and Sandy.
And then I drive by your place, and I'm, you know, these, you know, I'm sure they're nice people, but I mean, the house is just, the house is not what it was when the coffins were there. The house was so hip, you know. And but every time I walk by, I'm like, you know, it's just this is a tripped out situation. But I mean, the whole thing is psychedelic, but yet it's gravely serious because it could turn into a bad trip very quickly. This whole epidemic.
Yeah, it's terrifying stuff, and we're losing people, and it's sad, but it does, you know, we'll get to the other side of it, you know?
We will. I do wonder about, I just, from your own perspective, as you are, you know, sequestered there, I can't imagine, how old is your daughter?
She's 5. She's about to turn 6 next month.
Right. So this is interesting for her. She's a little bit young. She will remember it, definitely. I mean, my girls are 14 and 7, so they...
Oh wow!
Yeah, man, you got my girl. You will lose your mind when these girls are cosmic. But they you know, it's unprecedented, and I just wonder if you have thought, if anything, about how your point of view or your approach to just what I mean. You've always seen. I mean, even Russo in that quote, it was like very clear. Like he holds immense respect for you, and Perowski he loves, and Spencer Zahn and, you know, Goldberg or all these really badass musicians. And there's no ego there. And so you guys were already pretty open-minded, and it wasn't like Boyfriends was like, you know, I wish you guys had a 2-week residency at, you know, Skinny Dennis or something, but I mean, you weren't playing live a lot. And the question is like, when you come back, do you feel like you're going to have a different point of view from before? I mean, I guess the answer is pretty obvious, but do you know what it would be and how you're going to see it differently after we get to the other side, as you said?
I don't know. I don't know how. I don't know in what way
right.
I'll see it differently, other than I'll be incredibly thankful and grateful to be able to do it again. I really miss playing with my friends and and being around, in you know, a room, you know, of people. I don't know. I think we'll all adapt like we do. And it'll be, I think we'll all be changed, but I don't know if I'll be able, if I can really, you know.
Can you talk, is there a way to put it? No, I mean, but is there, like, because the music found you, Josh. I mean, you know, it's not like you were seeking it. I mean, you tapped into a frequency and you've been operating on it for quite a while. What is the feeling like for that plug to sort of, because I mean, listen, you can wank around, you know, you can wank in your room all you want, but I mean, you know, it's like, what is the feeling like when you are deprived of being able to, for lack of a better word, make love on the bandstand with your peers? I mean, how do you?
Yeah. Well, check this out. Yeah. So I am super, super lucky to be married to an incredible musician.
Oh.
My wife is an amazing bass player and singer, and we've been working together since those New Pulse days. But
She plays upright bass.
She plays upright bass.
Oh, that is ridiculous.
And upright bass, and she plays electric too. And so when this whole thing happened, we were out in L.A. working on a record, and we saw New York starting to close up, and we were like, we got to get home now. So we, the three of me and Clara and Annie, all got home, and we got home, and one of the first things we did was we cleaned out our walk-in closet, and we set up a little space where we could continue to work.
Wow.
So we had, you know, we have a two basses in here and a 12-string guitar on loan from a friend, and some other guitars that were left here, like, in between tours and stuff like that, and, like, patchwork together some like, little tones, some reverbs and echoes and stuff. I pulled in our nice speakers from the record player and put them in here. I set up a little studio. I have my great grandmother's card table, Gigi's card table, that I have it all set up on. And I'm in this closet right now. And I got to tell you, like, it is incredible to be able to disappear into this place and be able to connect musically with my wife. And you know, we have, you know, half hour here, an hour there after Clara goes to bed at night. And so we're still doing it, you know? We're working with what we got. And
that's incredibly fortunate to have that. That's a big walk. That's a big walk-in closet. I mean, you know, the thing, you know, it's like, I mean, like, I just, yeah, it is. My folks are handling it pretty well too, and they weren't like super go-go people to begin with. So, you know, mellowing out at home is not the biggest deal for them. But I just feel like this is such a novel thing and we live in this instantaneous informational time where it's like, I just worry about, I understand that it's unprecedented and that we're cooped up, and but the idea of pushing people back out due to the greed of capitalism, berserker capitalism, is, I mean, I just think that this is an unknown thing, and it's very and we don't have a lot of, and there's a lot of cognitive dissidence at the upper levels of government, which make it very difficult for me to feel comfortable.
I think that's the most aggravating part of it. I think there's, like, ways in which, you know, like, capital system is such a failed experiment to begin with, and I think this really points out the ways in which that's so.
I completely agree, but yet, like, it's going to be denied. Yeah. It's going to be triaged again and denied, and, you know, capitalism will save the day. You know, and it's like, you know, if we lived in a more evolved situation, we'd recognize that we could let things kind of fall apart and rebuild it and make it a little bit less perverted. You know, it's just, the whole thing is so, I mean, even before this, it was just like, I mean, it was just stark. Josh, I wanted to ask, this is an important question I ask a lot of the cats. This is, you know, you seem to have carved out, obviously, in production and as a musician, a lot of credibility. So you have your hands in a lot of different cookie jars, and your wife's a musician. So, you know, you might be an outlier, but I just, from your point of view, you talk about the Doors. I've interviewed Densmore. You know, you talk about, you know, these iconic groups, and even the Jazzers, you know, Kenny Burrell and all these guys. I mean, it's like, it seemed to me that at a time before we were even born, and I think Josh and I were both born in 1978, and there was a time in this country when a musician was seen as an actual profession. And I'm wondering now if you look at it, not for your own personal point of view, paying the bills, but do you believe that in this berserker capitalism society that a musician is still seen as a profession, or is music merely a musician's gift to the world? Because I hear more and more stories about people that, yes, they're going on tour, but at the end of the day, they're negotiating with the bars about, like, gas money. And, you know, maybe they'll get a little bit of dough, or they can play for the Door or pay to play. And the only cats that are really making money getting ahead are, you know, bands that our parents listen to that are still too. Tower of Power, Steve Miller, Journey. I mean, these are recognizable baby boomer bands that are making millions of dollars. And then everybody else is just scraping. And I wanted to get your thoughts on societally, if in this country, if you think that a musician is still viewed as a viable profession.
It's hard to say coming at it from the perspective of making my living doing this for so long, right?
How do you do it? So maybe the better question is, how do you do it?
I think by evolving and kind of like and stretching out. For me, a big part of it was you know, touring around as a sideman for years, playing with people. That was fine and good, but I think that the it got to a point where I could actually make a living doing this, making records with people, because I could have multiple projects going on at one time, you know. So for me, it's more like, you know, talking shop kind of question for me directly, because
let me ask you, this is so interesting.
Light into other people's music.
That's a better question. Is putting your producer hat on. How do you work with, I mean, people come and bring you on board. And you know, I wonder how you, if the priority for you is to make sure the music sounds, spirit, you know, if there's a certain spiritual quality of the music, or is the intent for you as a producer to try to, work with what the artists want you to work with. For instance, if they want little tunes that are radio friendly, you know, then do you switch to cater to them, or do you try to, because ultimately it's, I mean, I don't even know how you're supposed to drive, or you're supposed to monitor. So many cats I talk to, they're like, I make albums and you know, and then it's like, well, where do we get the music out? Where do we put it? What platform do we put it on in order for it to breathe and get legs? And that's all kind of a mystery, because obviously the concept albums and the things that we sort of grew up on, our parents' music, it doesn't really exist anymore. Does that factor into your work with people?
I still think about the format of the album. I don't think it's necessarily my job to isolate a specific quality of what someone else does and say, like, oh, this is, you know, this aspect of what they do is great for radio. I don't really understand how that part of it works at all. But I do think that first of all, I've been really blessed to work with people whose music that I like cherish. And I've been fortunate to be able to coexist inside the music, not just as like a listener, but a participator. Where I oftentimes I'll be like, you know, invited to produce a record and to have an opinion about what's going down musically that helps to steer things. But also I can do that, and I can speak to the musicians by playing with them too on the floor, you know? So for me, that's how I get involved with it. And try and steer it musically.
I mean, when did that become something when you really felt like you found your voice? I mean, that is a gift. That is, you're bringing something to the table. But that doesn't happen overnight. I mean, was there a defining moment when you felt like, as a producer, that you really, you really saved a session, or you really were able to, create a breakthrough for a group? I mean, ultimately, you want to leave whatever work you do and feel like that the people that you were working with were inspired by the final outcome, regardless of whether it sells a lot or not.
Inspired. I think inspired, and also feeling like they sound like themselves and they feel comfortable with that. Like, they have to wear it forever, you know? And
right.
That's something I don't ever want to freak myself out about, but that is something that I consider. It lasts, which is different than a gig. But I do try to treat it like a gig, like in terms of showing up and speaking to the moment. I think the first time I felt that way probably was there were a few transformative moments, like when I was younger, but hanging around like four tracks with friends in college, and feeling like when we left hanging out and working on a piece of music, we'd get in the car and go somewhere, and all we'd want to do is just listen to the thing we made over and over again. It felt so good.
Wow.
You know that feeling?
I do. Yeah. Like, believe me. When you do an interview with John Perry Barlow that's transcendent, you know, you just keep listening to it over and over again. You know, it's like insane. So I know that feeling, but it's different with a group. I mean, there is a lot more energy bubbling around when it's a band. So it's different.
Not to go on too much of a tangent here.
No, just riff away. Yeah, you can dive as deep as you want.
Brooklyn Bowl with him and some other friends doing Barlow songs.
I'm sorry. Who did you get to play with?
Oh, it was Graham Lesh. Do you know Graham?
I've interviewed Graham twice. Yeah, we've done some deep.
Oh,
yeah. So you played with
guy like
Graham,
incredibly sweet guy.
Elliot who else was in that band? Who else was playing those gigs?
I can't remember that night too well, but one thing what I was going to say is Ross was there.
Ross James, and, yeah.
Yeah.
I wonder if Alex Coford was playing drums or something like that.
Oh, yeah, Alex was there, that's right.
Dude, that dude is he's one of yeah. he's in, you know my
second drumming.
He's the sickest drummer, a great singer. So, I mean, Kaufman, the reason this is so cathartic is because I should have interviewed you like 5 years ago. I've interviewed every other cat, and you should have been the first one on the docket. But I guess this is the time, dude. William Patterson, this is like a serious like intervention by Rufus Reed and all these cats that were like, you need to reconnect with Josh Kaufman. I mean, it's unbelievable.
Wow. Amazing.
It's a spiritual thing, man. So anyway, you did the Barlow.
Say was I did this thing, and I guess it was one of Barlow's nurses in hospice care was there.
Yeah.
And she, I can't remember her name.
I think her name was, I know her name, Geraldine.
Oh, man, she'd be an amazing interview. She gave the most compelling, beautiful sort of, not a eulogy, but like shared some words.
No, I've actually interviewed her. I've interviewed her. She is, I think, a very good person and has done a lot of great work. Clearly, there was a little bit of it was like a rhythm section where there was a lot of push and pull. It wasn't fluid. My second book is literally I'm getting a proof copy today from Amazon. This book is on the Merry Pranksters, Wavy Gravy, the Grateful Dead Poets, and the Grateful Dead Side Projects.
Interesting.
So basically, Barlow's daughters gave me their blessing for my two interviews to go in that book. He's been in my, anyway, she was very, and I don't, just because we didn't have a great connection doesn't mean that her heart is not in the, I know what you're saying. She devoted her life to Barlow's, and which was just staggering because that first interview, the one I sent you, it was within a few months that he got this bizarre infection on his foot walking through an airport, and the next thing you know, his whole world got turned upside down and he was gone. It was just like insane because the guy was a total avatar. Yeah. Total avatar. It was just ridiculous. I mean, you know, and you just hear the, and you know, it's the, I that's sort of what I was getting at, Josh. I mean, not that you're not a rushed person. I mean, this is, we've already been weaving around for 40, I mean, we're going to have to do about 9 parts of this interview, but it's like, basically, I've always been saying to people say, you know, you're doing so many interviews, you're so active, you're on the road, you're losing your mind, you know, you're having a ball, like, why are you pushing so hard? And I said, because I have to approach all creativity with a sense of urgency. We don't know, we don't have a lot of time. I kept saying this over the last year, Josh. I kept saying, we don't have a lot of time. And I didn't even know what I was talking about. To me, it was like, you don't know, don't take anything for granted. That's kind of what I was getting at with this, you know, if and when we get past this Rubicon here with the coronavirus is, obviously you put gusto and passion to all your projects, but to me it was just like, now I know why I was going on tour with Circles Around the Sun to go see Neil Casale, because I mean, it was just like, that's just one example, but I was just, even as recently as going to see the Bogey Band, like, I mean, 2 months later, Brooklyn shut down. I mean, you just don't know when things, you just don't know. And I think that was the, and I just wonder if you've always had that sense of urgency too, or maybe it's, things have changed, you know, I mean, I'm sure.
No, I've always been a pretty restless guy.
I mean, it's different for you. It's actually, you are such, I mean, compared to this, I just wonder if you know, I mean, you can relate to the question I asked you related to musician as a profession. You do know, you do recognize that there are many friends of yours that don't have the skills in production and things like that, and they are scuffling. I mean, you recognize that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
That, to me, is an existential crisis because, you know, music for me, I mean, I used to go see Brian Blade or Bill Frisell at Boston University, you know, on a Friday night and, you know, maybe eat some mushrooms because that was what my friends were doing. So, like, you know, or I'd go see, you know, Billy Martin and Rock Along Bob Moses play double drums at the Somerville Theater or something like that. But I, or even like Gil Scott-Heron, you know, but I'd never, I always looked at it like that was what I was supposed to do socially. It wasn't a spiritual thing. And now it's like it doesn't matter if it's something at Lunatico or Josh Kaufman and his wife or, you know, whatever it is, I want to let the body dance. I want to just have a descarga, a complete discharge, spiritual discharge at all costs. It is healing for me. It never used to be like that. And now music is completely healing for me. And so it's very, this, for me, it's been hard to not be on the road and to not be experiencing that vibration. I think that's what you were talking about in those drives in the car at New Paul's, just the idea that you guys wanted to hear it over and over again because it was recreating that energy that everybody was giving off at that time. And it's, for people not to, that's what I'm saying. If our society just sees music as multitasking stuff or background or pacification, then that's not good for a civilization or a culture. It really is not. I mean, you have to.
Yeah.
The significance of music is important.
This goes back. I'm so sorry. I'm so
no,
sorry
it's fine. It's fine. No, go ahead.
It kind of goes back to that idea of sort of the capitalist structure too, because I think that when you look at music as you know, a place to fill a something to attract people to fill a room of ticket buyers, you're not looking at it as sort of like the way that you're coming at it, which is as like a cultural moment to congregate around to fill yourself back up for the rest of the things in life that are these sort of unknowns.
Exactly.
And you need that fuel to get through.
I mean, isn't it fair to say that your dad got through medical school by going to see music? I mean, maybe I'm really off on that, but I mean, I know doctors that went to SUNY Stony Brook in the early 70s, and I mean, they had Mahavishnu Orchestra, Led Zeppelin. I mean, the Dead were coming. I mean, they were going to Pritchard Gym. Yeah, it's 2,000 people.
Yeah, but I think my dad.
maybe I wasn't sure. But if both your parents were music heads, I know your mom was a culture freak, but I wasn't sure about.
Yeah. Both of them are for sure. My dad is like a little more aggressive with his like going to shows and buying records than always has been. But
oh, that is sick. That is so sick.
Yeah. So but no, they I think that's how my dad probably got through college proper, not medical school, and high school. But by the time the 70s hit, they got married very quickly after they met, and they moved to Rome, where my dad went to medical school, because at the time, believe it or not, it was difficult for Jews to get into medical school in the States.
This is soul food for me, man. I mean, this is the most I've done so 1,500 interviews. This is in the top five by far. I had no idea that was even the case. Even in the 70s, that was still a problem.
Isn't that wild?
Well, I'm just surprised because, I mean, money talks, right? I mean, there was still that prejudice. Although, you know, the truth is that I'm transcribing my interview with Brian Jackson, who was Gil Scott Heron's writing partner, and they went to Lincoln University, which was an all-black school in Pennsylvania, and he's talking about the way the Klan existed in the late 60s, not the way the Klan existed in the 40s and 30s. So it was like, you know, you're beginning to see this thing where it's like, it's always there. It's just changing. But yeah, when it comes to like a Jew going to medical school in today's world, that's like not an issue, but it was then, which is fascinating.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's where they were until they had me when they came back to the States in the late 70s. So my parents always say like they had... They skipped the 70s.
You know, but I wonder for them if they looked, if, you know, if they instilled some sort of unconscious thing in you to be like, Josh, be as creative as you want and recognize that there, you know, to me, it doesn't matter what the genre or style, but there has to be a spiritual quality of in music. I mean, John Coltrane... Miles was bored to death of bebop, so he went towards the electric stuff. But, I mean, you look at Coltrane's like, okay, I don't want jazz to become some sort of, you know, antiquated standards-based thing. And so he started to fuse that spiritual, burning, modal music that I think, I hope if I was a journalist at that time, I wouldn't have been calling it hate music, but I can't say that definitively. A lot of people did. A lot of the audiences were white. A lot of women got up and said, make him stop. But it was the point was, it was so misinterpreted because it was so spiritual. And I guess that's kind of what I wanted to ask you about is how you always keep, or how important it is to have that spiritual component attached to, could be campfire songs with Weir, boyfriends, abstract jazz. How do you always keep that? How do you try to keep that spiritual element in the music? And is it about... in the studio trying to recreate a live vibe?
So I guess the answer to the first part is...
sorry, there's always multi-part questions.
It's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
let's take a quick turn.
Yeah.
I guess I don't really have... I don't have a method other than just listening. And that's how I find I feel like shut up and listen is the way that I try and approach those situations, regardless of the kind of music it is. I don't think the idiom really matters. And it's more exactly, it's exactly what you've been saying. It's about the feeling and the emotion and the catharsis more than anything else for me.
I
and
think then that, the, exactly. That's and exactly then, what it is.
And then the other side of that question, how do you create that in the studio? I don't know. But I think that you're looking for people I don't know. I think
let me just read you. I want to read
in different shapes. Sometimes it comes. You know, like so. I remember working on this Bonnie Light Horseman record, this record of folk music I made with my friend Anais Mitchell and Eric Johnson, and from the Fruit Bats. And Anais, we were working. We were like up late one night last winter. We were finishing up the recordings, and she was just like, she's like, oh man, this is so easy. Is it? It feels so good. Does it mean that it's good? Because it's easy. Because I've never made music that I thought that was good, that was easy to make. And I was like, oh man, I don't know. I've had the exact opposite experiences. So I think it's
dude,
for
what
everyone.
A blessed life, man. Because what she just said is that's you're pushing so hard to make something that, I mean, for you to have this sort of, did you recognize it a certain, I mean, this is a little bit abstract, but Miroslav Vicius from, the original bass player from Weather Report, when I interviewed him, he talked about Wayne Shorter and Alphonse Mouzon. They were able to allow the music to come through them from the heavens. Zawinul was a spiritual player, but he was a little bit more insecure. So, like, if they got too free, he'd want to bring it back, and he'd, you know, play some chords that would sort of bring the music back. But the point is, did you recognize at a certain point, Josh? Because what you just said there was so profound. It was like, you know, you did you recognize at a certain point that you were merely a conduit for the music coming through you from the heavens?
I don't know. I don't think so.
I love your honesty. No, you know what it is? Where it's like the
I feel that way. I don't think I feel that way yet. But I like surrendering to it.
I think that's what I'm trying to say.
Wherever it's coming from. Yeah.
How did you?
I enjoy surrendering to it, and I enjoy in the middle of something that I've never done before, like being like what is controlling me right now? Actually, that band Boyfriends that you talked about earlier
I'm obsessed with that band.
And Bogey is one of those groups that takes me to that place where, like, you know, 20 minutes into some, you know, I guess maybe on the surface obtuse starting point, we're all of a sudden making, what is going on, you know? And and I think that feeling is worth chasing, and valuable for people to be around and exposed to. Because I think that people that come and want to be open, that are open to that kind of music, it serves the whole room in a deep way, and I guess you can call it spiritual, but I don't know where it comes from, but it's an incredible magnet that pulls people into the center of it, musicians and listeners. It's all the same.
We've reached the 60-minute threshold. Can we set up part 2?
I know.
Can we set up part 2? I mean, this is not unheard of. I've done multiple interviews. Yeah. So I mean, let's just do part 2 next week or something.
That's great. This is a great time, I think, in our lives to reconnect.
Josh, honestly, man, I'm telling you, I know you're not on new media. I don't believe you're on social media, at least Facebook. You know, like, I recognize that you're really locked into your muse. You're following the muse, even amidst all these times when there are restrictions. You know, you can play music with your family, your immediate family. You know, you have gigs, you know, you're blessed, and I know I've been blessed, and I want you to continue on the righteous path, because And it's very divine that we've reconnected through, you know, the indefatigable Joe Russo and Stuart Bogey. Those guys are, I mean, salt of the earth cats, man. It's just,
yeah,
I mean,
that is exactly what they are. Yeah, they're amazing, and I never would have guessed. You know, I've been fans of both of them for so long. I don't think 20 years ago I would have guessed like I'd be, you know, around them as much as I am in such a deep way. They're such special people, and I always, you know, kind of go to the well and find them there. They're so cool.
Well, the well's not run dry yet, Kaufman. We'll get set two going next week. But dude, Sean Quinlan, man, thank God for that cat. Jesus.
Seriously.
Yeah, man. Have a beautiful. It was so good to hear your voice, man. Much love to the entire family.
Oh, same to you, Jake. It's great to hear you.
All right,
man.
Talk to you soon. Later. Reconnecting with old friends, Josh Kaufman. That's it for the Jake Feinberg Show. We'll be back. See you.